So glad to see you back. Have we got a show for you? We are going to nerd out on macro communities, organization culture, and art. All of my favorite topics. So you know by now, we blur our personal and professional life. Today's guest on the PeopleNova podcast is a prime example. We met socially, realized we both participate at Burning Man, and have different skill sets, yet nerd out about organization culture. Stick around because we're going to discuss mission-driven organizations, probably similar to yours, while chatting with Victoria Mitchell, a business operations expert putting stellar systems in place. I'm here today with a very good friend, Victoria Mitchell. Victoria, say hello.
Hi, hello.
Victoria, give the audience a quick introduction of kind of who you are and how you're amazing.
Thanks for the amazing compliment, right back at you. So I'm Victoria. Currently I work for Burning Man Project. That's my day job. So I'm a director there. I oversee things like cultural strategy and business operations, which we're a nonprofit, but we still, you know, have to think about how we bring in the revenue and how we support our program areas. And many other, you know, other interesting projects over the years. But, you know, overall, I'm an operations kind of gal at my core. But I've, you know, been in the startup world. I've been in the food industry, you know, spent many years in San Francisco doing, you know, being in community with people, you know, in so many ways. And now here in Boston, figuring out, you know, the next chapters of my life, which is very exciting.
I do want to double click on something you said. Even though, so you work for a nonprofit. I help, I'm on the board of a not-for-profit artisans asylum. It's amazing. Go check it out, everyone. And it's interesting because I agree with that sentiment. Like, even though you're a not-for-profit, you are still running a business, right? Like, you have to have sound principles. You have to have sound accounting, right? That's where a lot of like guide star ratings come into play. But you really have to think about it as like, we're running a business. We can sell our service, which is like, like shocking in not-for-profit world, right?
Oh, because, yeah. No one wants to talk about that.
No, right? Because people are like, oh, you're supposed to give things out for free. And it's like, well,
if only we could, you know, I mean, we're still existing within a capitalist economy. And so we have to, you know, we still have to survive, and we call it income instead of profit, but it's the same thing.
Right,
you know?
Exactly. Earned income versus contributed income, right? Yep. And what do you do with the surplus? Will you reinvest that back in your organization and back in your mission, right?
There's some like overarching rules essentially that direct, you know, what happens with that income in a way that's different from a for-profit or different from a B Corp as well, which is kind of almost the middle ground these days, right? So, you know, the rules sit on top of that and, you know, legally say you're going to direct your efforts this way versus towards shareholder value. But at the end of the day, you still ultimately want to sustain your organization. You want it to exist for hopefully a very long time. The compelling part of the nonprofit is whatever the mission is.
Right.
But businesses have missions too. It's not like they're that different, you know?
Okay, great. Exactly. This is where I want to go, right? Because you and I we're both working in the startup space, right? So again, not-for-profit, mission-driven, like clear as day, like, you know, hunger, save the world, art, creativity, like all that, right? Great. Love it. But even in the startup space, like I work with a lot of clients that are like, oh, well, how do I hire talent? You know, we're mission-driven to like disrupt innovation, favorite phrase. ironic and overused, but we all have missions, right? So what has been your interaction with like working with startups and mission-driven organization?
I got a lot of my chops, you know, being in San Francisco, you know, surrounded by the, you know, startup boom where there's an Uber for this and an Airbnb for that. And even watching friends working at companies like Airbnb and Twitter and all these folks just like go from tiny to you know, and then all of these smaller companies wanting to replicate that success, you know, and find their way to be the unicorn too. All the while you're seeing how business as usual, you know, and kind of larger industries are, you know, the kind of door is getting battered down, you know, by these smaller companies that are growing, and the way we're interacting is changing. And I think like at the end of the day, you know, there's this human thing. It's a human thing to want to, you know, have what work I do every day, and so much of my life being the work that I do, actually have some meaning.
Yeah.
Actually have something, you know, that I can point to and say, wow, I've done some good today. Yeah. And, you know, and whether it's conscious or unconscious, you know, I think for many people, that is just something they're thinking and concerned about. And so I think startups really kind of took a very direct approach to that, and really accelerated the mission on the wall, and the culture is lived and real, and it's not just on our website. And, mm-hmm. you know, larger companies and industries are replicating that, but they didn't come up with it either. I mean, I would kind of look back to essentially nonprofits. It's like they've been doing it all along.
They're the OG cultures.
So, yeah. And so,
that's great.
You know, startups are just trying to tap into that thing where, and, you know, I'm sure you have things to say about this. I mean, nonprofits are amazing and incredibly difficult because people have so much passion and care for the mission. They will sacrifice themselves, they'll sacrifice their families, they'll sacrifice everything for the mission. And that cycle of burnout that you see in nonprofits, you also see in startups, right?
Yeah.
Like it's all very similar, but just with a different focus. I think startups are often kind of looking for the big money on top of the impact, right? And nonprofits are more the social good or whatever the mission connects to personally.
Yeah.
And both have incredible hiring benefits, right?
Yeah, they do.
Yeah.
They can absolutely coexist, right? And you can find amazingly talented people that really care about, you know, the spotted tree frog. Awesome. Cool. Like, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. We all want to feel like what we're doing is contributing. How have you helped kind of uncover that with folks that you've worked with, people who maybe who've worked for you? Yeah.
I think it's very personal, but also not very personal at the same time. So, you know, in my role as a manager of many people over the years, you know, development is always a key part of that relationship. You know, I think it's part of the responsibility that as someone's, you know, appointed leader, so to speak, like that, you know, you want to give back into that and help guide, you know, what that person is looking for next, or if they don't even know, you know, provide some good questions and some good conversation to help them get there, you know. And so I think there's a big kind of, I'm seeing it more, it's hard to tell how widespread it actually is, but I'm seeing a lot more coming out right now around like, what are your values? What is your personal mission? It's kind of like, do you remember like 5-ish years ago, it was all about your personal brand and everyone was like getting all up about what's your personal brand? Da, 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 da.
It's so
like
important. Now, you have to have a brand.
Yeah. And I think that was because it was like the age of like, everyone has an online profile now across multiple platforms. And so people had to figure out like, how do I aggregate that? And who am I across all of these things? And I think now we're in this, you know, next kind of phase, I guess, of whatever that is, you know, of like, what's my personal mission? What are my personal values? On my website, I actually made up, this was just me, you know, using something that I made for myself, like a little spreadsheet-y approach to, you know, taking one's own personal values. I don't get into the how you define that. There's so many different resources for how one could define that. But how in the middle of a transition moment, something where you're like, what do? Do I take this job or that job? Do I go down this path or that path? Like how you can rank different things against your values and kind of see, you know, the differences of how they, a different choice could impact you, or even more interestingly, retrospectively seeing where certain things were not the best fit, you know, for oneself. So it's a tool that's just kind of, I just developed on my own, and then I just wanted to share it with people. So I just put it up online. But, you know, I think that's all to say that, you know, whenever someone is unsure, you know, or unclear about what path they're walking down or why they're working where they're working or doing what they're doing with the majority of their time, I think there is something valuable in the values concept. And I think part of that is the part I was saying earlier about how it's personal and not personal. The not personal part is that ultimately we are a part of so many systems of culture around us, whether that's our organization that we're a part of, whether it's the community, like the local community we're in, the region, the country, religious communities, you know, various kind of dimensions of our lives. Like we are part of those things. And so we import a lot of values, you know, from, you know, the way we're raised and how we're brought up and our parents and our families or whoever. And so that part is less choiceful, you know? It's kind of like the default setting a little bit that like one inherits.
This is what I've always done.
Experiences.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, okay. And then there's a point where you can start to be more choiceful and say, oh, are these really the values that I want to hold and express and hold others to? Because we hold other people to our values all the time.
All the time. Whether we know we do or we don't.
Yeah.
I always tell people if I'm like, chatting with you, I'll be like, right, you know, the thing of the, okay, if we play charades, this means, thing, right? Like I consciously tell people, right? And I'm a kinesthetic learner, right? So I put that whenever I do a workshop, I'm like, okay, y'all need to like pick up the thing and like handle it, right? I know that about me, but I'm at least aware that I'm doing that to other people.
Yeah,
so I put myself
and most
out.
Of the time we aren't, you know, so. I think as an individual, we are looking for that quote fit, which is where the whole, I mean, you and I have geeked out about culture fit before. And I have some strong opinions of, I think culture fit is often used as a bludgeon, you know, and it didn't start that way, but it's over the past couple of years, it's become such a, it's like, here's our company's values. Now we're going to meticulously assess this person to see if they fit these values. And if they don't fit these values, then we're not going to hire them.
Yeah.
Like it's really like mathed out almost,
yeah. You know,
in a way that I don't think you can do it that way. It's not that that's inherently wrong, but I don't think it actually leads to the best composition of humans, you know, in your organization, because while you want to have a value and you want to have clarity over what you're trying to, how you're going to do business differently than others, you know, or how you're going to do business in a way that's aligned with the macro cultures that you're a part of. Maybe you're really just affirming things, you know, that are going on in the culture more generally. But either way, like, you know, I think that there's a zone around the value of where you want people to sit. You don't want everyone to be smack dab in the middle of this is exactly the definition, you know, our founders of our company or our board or our
and hold it as
leadership
like a sacred
have.
Truth. And,
yeah, you need a little range around that. You need people who question it from both ends of whatever the poles are around the value, because around every value, there are other things going on that you can kind of pull apart. Yeah. And so if you kind of know what's the range around it and you kind of decide, okay, what's the stretch? Because if someone's too far outside of it, then you're going to have culture clash in a way that's not productive and you can't get work done. Or you just get work done way less effectively. but you know, I mean, all that just goes back to the many, many studies and findings of like more diversity is better, you know, in your organization in order to produce better results, period. You know, so how do you fit culture, you know, with enough diversity and that range, you know, to help actually produce the best results for whatever it is you're trying to do.
Yes, I 100% agree. I think diverse is like the best.
Yeah.
I can't say that word. Mm-hmm. Heterogeneous, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
A couple things I want to talk on. First off, love the fact that you put all of your values in a spreadsheet. You like love that.
That's very, some people will be able to relate to that and some people will be like, what are you talking about? So
I heard that. I was like, oh my God, I love that.
Yeah.
I've done similar exercises, but they're mostly in journals, right? And so like, again, I'm a tactile learner. I will journal things and I'll just put it on my shelf. And then like, you know, 7 years go later and I open it up and I'm like, oh, yeah. Okay. I thought that time too.
Yeah. Yeah.
I forget this. Right. Mm-hmm. So mine's a little bit more disorganized. That's just how I work.
Yeah.
But love the fact that you're here in spreadsheet. And another thing I heard you say was like all the different macro communities we're in, whether it's work, whether it's home, whether it's social, right. I call those my Venn diagrams, right? Like all these different circles of like, what is Rachel involved in? And, oh, she does this, right? And I was talking with a new colleague recently and I was like, yeah, I do this and I do this. And they're like, wow, you're a connector, aren't you? You're like a people connector. And I'm like, I guess I am. Yeah. I didn't think of it that way, but you know, to someone who was newly understanding, you know, what my values are, right. And this goes to another point. You know, that naturally revealed itself. And it's, there's a great TED talk by the CEO of Twilio. I can't think of his name right now. Where he's like, look, you don't just name values and put them on the wall because they sound good. You actually you uncover them, right? Mm-hmm. And so as a collection, you know, an organization, whether you're a for-profit or not-for-profit or just a group of friends, right? Mm-hmm. You know, going camping in the desert, you come together for, right?
Yeah.
Particular reason, right? And like, why do you do it time after time? And what are the things, right, that you uncover if we play charades?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right? And so how do you kind of reflect inwardly and look at that? How do you articulate those things? How do you share those things, you know, with the people that you interact with? Later today, I'm doing a workshop, and it really is about a lot of self-awareness and uncovering things that are important when you're going into initial conversations with co-founders around equity, right?
Mm.
And I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to tell you what the best answer is, because frankly, I don't think there is a thing like the best, right?
It's like
what makes sense for that particular dynamic, right? So how do we go through that self-awareness of what's important to me? What do I prioritize? You know, what are the fringe things? What are the things I can let roll off? What are things that I'm going to die on the stake? Like, this is important. This is a must. Right. And I think it's really similar to that value system of uncovering it.
Mm-hmm. So I'm a systems person. I love to think about the invisible, typically systems that are behind the things that we do. And I think in this context of companies and organizations are really guiding so much of what's happening. Like I said, we have this choicefulness, we have this ability to do it our way, so if we so choose, but if we don't do that very consciously, typically we're going to act out the way the system is set up, you know, that looks like, okay, I agreed to take this job. Okay, this is the set of responsibilities I have. Okay, those responsibilities are part of, you know, a web of responsibilities that I and my immediate colleagues and then circles of colleagues around me and all the different kind of pieces of an org chart, right? Different departments or functions, you know, are all kind of adding up to collectively do what, right? And I think the what part is really interesting. Like, how does this layer up and then how do you take it down to the individual level? So when you're looking at, you know, when you're really looking at like, what is business, which is a really important question, I think, to ask, like, what the heck is business?
What is the meaning of life? What are we here for? Okay, got it.
yeah. What is business? Okay, so in my mind, business is a series of exchanges that we agree to make, you know, typically in exchange for resources, for experiences, for services. You could probably add a couple more kind of generalizations there. But, you know, we do these things, and business has existed longer than capitalism. You know, capitalism sits on top. It's a set of particular rules. You know, it's the way that we do economics today. But economics is kind of like business. Economics is very long, you know, kind of science essentially of, you know, how do people do these exchanges and what's kind of at the root, things like supply and demand, things that are valued higher or lower at particular times. Like, I'm not an economist, but there's some kind of deep stuff here that, you know, if you look back in human history, okay, you know, there's been forms of socialism that have existed for all of human time and exist currently in modern contexts that are, you know, really established and connected to governments. But, you know, senses of socialism kind of dominated the way that we did exchange, the way that we, you know, dealt with our resources and did these things. We bartered, you know, before we had money, didn't need money, wasn't part of the equation. Yeah. But this resource I have is perhaps very highly valued, you know, and maybe what you have is less valued. So you give me more of that for less of my thing, you know, and we sort that out. And, you know, we might as person to person have our conception of what that is. But as human societies grew, we developed some collective assumptions around that that we operated on. Yeah. And that allowed us to do exchanges from group to group rather than person to person, you know, and then all of a sudden, you know, societies developed, not just for that reason, but things get more complex. We have feudalism, right? Like different forms, like before capitalism, we have things like feudalism, you know, all these things. And then we have, okay, capitalism. Here comes capitalism. Cool.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of economists are like, great, we found the answer. It's capitalism. It works, you know? And then there are people who would be like, it does not work. There are big problems. Let's do it this other way. And then you think about, okay, what is money? You know, like, how does money play into it? Now we have this representation of accumulated value, you know? And so when I sign up for that job and I agree to this set of responsibilities, that is valued in within the system. It's valued in my local area, you know, because there might be a lot of me, people who have my skill set. There might be not that many of me. There might be high demand. Like, there's a lot of reasons why we need people like me, or there might not be much at all, you know? And so I'm kind of on the outs a little bit of the system and trying to find my way in for someone who wants what I'm offering, you know? And I'm offering skills, I'm offering experience, I'm offering my labor, I'm offering these things to do whatever it is that a larger entity needs to do, needs me to do, or I'm going to do it person to person if that's my game. So all of that is like, okay, great. I find a way to exchange my value for accumulated value, which is money, you know, and this exchange is happening. So great. I'm, you know, doing business as a person. I'm doing business with my employer, you know, I'm thanks for the money and I'm going to go use that to exchange my value, accumulated value for other businesses as a consumer. You know, like the coffee shop down the street right now, I want to keep them in business despite the pandemic. And so I put on my face mask and I walk out the door and I go get my latte from them because, you know, I want to help them out. And I happen to still have a job. And so I still have some accumulated value that I can freely spend and I don't have to hoard or conserve. So,
it's but you're like, choiceful about it. And I love that word. You're choiceful.
Yeah.
Because I think a lot of people forget that we have choices. And, you know, I've gone through my own, mental wellness journey and a lot of it was, retraining neural pathways, right? Retraining the just subconscious choices I was making that wasn't serving me. Right. And being more intentional, being more choiceful. And so, making sure to dialogue about self-awareness, you know, what's going on, what are those choices that you're making? And how do you, if you're unhappy, right? How do you set those intentions? How do you small change? What, like one change, what can you choose to do today? Simple, small. It doesn't need to be like, you know, canvas the earth with, you know, save the trees kind of a thing, but it's like, oh, I'm going to go with, I'm going to go to the coffee shop with my reusable mug. Great. Those are choiceful things that we can do, to interact with the humans.
Yeah. And like, we can make choices that are for the social good, you know? And I think that back to kind of the initial part of our conversation, you know, that's where we want to do things that are mission aligned or mission oriented, you know? So I want to work for an organization that has a strong mission, whether it's for profit or nonprofit, you know, and nonprofits, by the way, are still having to navigate capitalism, even though they have a different operating model, they still have to, you know, have something of value that is worth donating to, you know, that's worth philanthropic support, that's worth grants, that's worth exchange just straight up money for services from people, you know, there's some immediate value there. Like that all still has to be in the equation. But as an individual, I want, you know, to be part of something that feels aligned with my values. And so when you kind of layer culture on top of this, you know, and kind of the human element, you know, there's so many different ways that we do business, like depending on the cultures we're a part of and the customs are different and the code, you know, by which we do things is different. And when we have the same code, we're from the same culture, you know, it's a lot, it just kind of creates a slipperiness. It's like smoother to exchange the resources, exchange the services, because we're both wearing suits and ties. So we get that we're both professionals and that we're both going to be, you know, we're both kind of using the same, you know, code behind us. That's what we at least think we visualize that and we assume that, and we assume that there's less risk because of that, because, oh, that person's kind of showing up in a similar way to I am,
or they know how to interact with lingo.
They would clearly have an MBA too, because we're both using these like terms or whatever the thing, or, you know, clearly this person's been in this industry for 20 years like I have, because they know all, have all this deep knowledge of all these little, like little words, little things, you know? And so we want to be a part of, we want to be able to show our value. We want to be able to express that. We want to be able to get something in exchange for that to, you know, improve our lives and, you know, be able to support our families and, you know, do all the things that we need to do. But it's just so interesting how then culture is like kind of the slipstream that layers on top of it, or it's stopping block where we're like, oh,
yeah,
I don't know about that person. I, that's, I don't know about what they're thinking or what they're trying to do. You know, I don't think I can get involved with them, or we shouldn't hire them, or we shouldn't do business with them. Whatever.
They don't have the pedigree of the university. They mm-hmm. didn't actually go to, you know, a top tier school to learn software coding. They just did a boot camp. Mm-hmm. I get that tension a lot, and I'm just like, yeah, because universities can't produce at a quick enough rate to get people into the work. That's kind of why, right?
Yeah.
And I really have to keep encouraging decision makers and hiring managers to open up. You know, what is what are the elements they're looking for when, and I say this, going to market to look for talent. Yeah. And you're like, why do that's so like rude? And I'm like, it's not, it's human capital. Like my labor, my knowledge has value. Mm-hmm. And so when you go to market, you're looking at, you know, what is the value that someone can bring to my organization, to my mission? Mm-hmm. And you know, it's not that, does it fit, but can it advance the mission, right? Mm-hmm. And again, going back to the TED talk the Twilio guy gave, it was, you know, are they not incongruent with the values? Can they contribute? And I think, I'm not sure if it was in the TED talk or not, but one of the other elements is, can they show us how we can do it better?
Mm-hmm. Right? Yep. Can they be additive? Yep. Mm-hmm.
Can they be additive, right? Can we bring different perspectives? Mm-hmm. And figure out, all right, what are the friction points? How do we help acclimate people so they know a few of the basics, right? Like our values, like 10 principles, right? Like our personal mission. How can we educate them to understand what that friction is and move through that? But then, you know, what about our mission? Can we do better? Can we serve better? Mm-hmm. What have we not thought about, right? And I like to reframe that sometimes, think about how do I help illuminate my blind spots?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
We all have them.
Well, and ultimately, I think there's a core thing going on there. You know, when you think about like the reality of, you know, any organization, you know, company, what have you, which is a, you know, compilation of human beings.
Yep.
Existing within this larger system of, you know, economics or capitalism and doing business within that for whatever their thing is, you know, stuff changes. There's change happening all the time. And some industries move faster than others, but it's easy to lose your competitive advantage. It's easy to lose who you're serving because someone comes along and can do it better or do it cheaper or do it, you know, however. And when you look at the approach of an organization or a company to their mission and values, I think there's a core alignment there that kind of probably speaks to how they're going to operate in the wider space around them. So if I, you know, let's say I'm the founder of this company and I have a very prescriptive approach to my culture, I'm looking for this thing very specifically. And I'm doing that across the board. I think it's always reasonable to have a couple of things that you do really specifically need this. But, you know, I'm kind of applying that lens to the way I'm hiring, to, you know, when people come up with new ideas, you know, within the organization, whether I'm open to them or not, or whether it's like, no, that doesn't fit with the strategy that we have, you know, for the next, you know, year or so, sorry, we're not going to listen to that. And and that kind of stuff trickles down, you know, it might be particularly intense at one level of an organization, but usually that kind of stuff filters and it's just part of the code, right? Of like how we do things in this company, how we do things in this business. When that happens, and then all of a sudden, you know, that business gets like hit in the side, you know, by like, where did this competitor come from? How did this happen? We had no idea. And it's like, oh, it's because we got really overly structured and rigid. Yeah. And it's natural for that to happen as organizations grow. And it's the classic, like the large companies want what the startups want what the large companies have. They both have some things going on that are advantageous. Large companies have a lot of resources at their disposal. They can move juggernauts if they choose to, you know, or they can go really slow, right? Like, and startups are like, oh my God, I wish I had these resources. I wish I had this capital. I wish I was known.
If only I had this. I could change the world.
And the big ones are like, how do we innovate? How do we move faster? How do we like get rid of some of this bureaucracy that's weighing us down?
The entrenchment and get new products to market faster. Yeah.
Yeah. And ultimately you need a little bit of both, you know? And so But I think the way that culture happens within an organization is very telling. And you also have startups that do this too. They're very specific and very strict and very rigid, you know, in how they're kind of starting and showing up. And that's going to be part of how they scale. Yeah. And so, and they're also perhaps more likely to get kind of hit in the side, you know, because they're looking at it with blinders on of like, this is the thing I'm doing. There's a balance of prescriptive and descriptive. And, you know, you referenced the 10 principles of Burning Man, you know, that's an example of a set of values, you know, and those are quite descriptive. They don't tell you how to do the thing.
Yeah.
It's, you know, an example of one is participation and radical inclusion and, you know, leave no trace. Like these are pretty high, you know, kind of minded things. They're not so like, you're going to do it this way. And there's tension baked into them to where it's not a cohesive set of like, here are the 10 commandments of how you should live. And they all fit very nicely
together. If you do step
together.
One and step two yep. and step three, then you won. Like, yep. yeah, they're yeah. not like that. And I love that. Yeah. I also yeah. love that there's description behind it because oftentimes I see people be like, oh, I value integrity.
And respect and like good communication. You're like, what
okay,
is
this
good
is subject to a lot of interpretation there, people. So like yeah. work with me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's so cool. I see that too in organizational values. I'm like, if you're too descriptive and like too like hot, you know what I mean?
Flowery
so
and like,
yeah, you're just yeah. like, here's a list of words that mean absolutely nothing, you know, because yeah. they can't be applied. It's just like, be respectful. Okay, are most people not respectful? In you know, I mean, I think that happens perhaps outside the workplace more, but in the workplace, you know, it's you know, getting less and less common that you have, you know, strong cultures of disrespect, you know, going
yes.
on. So it's like, what do you really mean by that? Like, what kind of respect? Have you had issues with sexism in the workplace or harassment? Okay, like, let's get a little bit more specific that that's
right.
actually what we're trying to ensure is, you know, is a meritocracy or equality or whatever it is you're shooting for, you know?
Right.
So
is it a power distance? Like respect the
yeah.
hierarchy. Like, I don't
yeah, know. It might be that. Maybe there's been a lot of like rebellion within the ranks of the organization. So we really mean like respect the hierarchy. Okay, great. Now we know. Now I know if I'm going to join your organization, if I like to work within
great.
Hierarchical systems, and then I can find that fit. But if I'm like, oh, there's not going to be a lot of room for my different way of doing things, then I shouldn't say yes to your offer. I shouldn't pursue
no matter
that
how lucrative,
interview
no
more
matter
further. Yeah.
How like branding and how amazing it mm-hmm. is to work at famous company here. It really comes down to like, does what I believe in align with what they mm-hmm. got going on?
Yeah.
And that's often where I see a lot of tension of like, oh, Rachel, this human isn't working, or like, oh, we hired the
mm-hmm.
wrong person. Okay, well, were we self-aware? Like I always start
mm-hmm.
with the organization before we start, you know, trying to performance coach or like deal with a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, okay, but if we weren't clear about a hierarchy, or if we weren't clear about tensions in our like structure,
or what the role actually was meant to
role.
Do. Maybe
right.
we had a job description that actually wasn't what this role is doing. And it wasn't anyone's fault. We just didn't realize it. But I've made some misfires, right? Mishires, essentially, where there wasn't the right fit. And it's just to like look back a little bit, I think it kind of, sometimes it's because I was too fixed on, I need this particular skill set
mm-hmm.
and I'm going to ignore some other things about mm-hmm. this person, you know, that don't maybe seem right because I'm looking for a blank specialist and
yeah.
this person has the experience or the skill set that really fits into blank type of specialist,
yeah.
you know, and so it's again, the blinders on and it's like, oh, except that's not working. And I think, you know, a lot of it, a lot of common sense, you know, kind of stuff that, you know, I'm sure you've seen too, is like when you hire for people's ability to learn something, their interest in the thing, you know, and enough skill and experience to match the level of seniority, the level of decision-making authority that person's going to have, you know, but ultimately like they're really into the thing, you know, that the role will be doing and they're, you know, they're willing to learn, like they
right.
are, they're ready to jump in and figure it out. And they want to build relationships in this area because it matters to them on whatever level, you know, like that's kind of more of the recipe for success in hiring. And I've seen some incredible people come up, you know, who it might have felt like a gamble at the time, but then you're like, whoa, look at them. That is, yes.
Crushing it. So,
yeah.
I like, instead of saying smart, because I have like the sense of like, oh, I'm not quite sure that's the right vocabulary. I like to talk about growth mindset. Right. And that learning orientation.
Yeah.
And this comes from me realizing I am a recovering perfectionist. Like I was a very binary person. Like either I was successful or I failed, right? Either I'm smart or I'm stupid, right? And knowing that that was an autonomous conversation in my head, like that just happened. And realizing that there was a choice. I could choose to learn from these interactions. Like even if it wasn't the best hire, I could still learn and debrief and say to myself, okay, what was the approach there? Was it me not being clear, or was it me being fixated, or, you know, did someone try to illuminate my blind spot and I was not letting that
or my ego got in the way, you know, like that's a very, especially in startups, that's, I was talking actually to a founder around here who I'm getting to know. And, you know, we were kind of chatting about like lessons learned, you know, and one of the things I was sharing was there was a point, you know, with the startup I was a part of, early on, especially, you know, I was kind of at the early edge of like, can I do this? You know, I was a little bit fragile in that sense and just trying to like breakneck, keep up, you know, and learn fast enough to do my job. And my job was changing every single day. And we were hiring for a management position that would report into me because we were kind of creating the next layer of management.
Great. Organization design. Love it.
Yep. here it's coming in. You know, I have too many direct reports. Time to add the layer.
Yeah.
And I remember interviewing somebody who, you know, on paper was great, was, you know, in the interview great. And looking back, the reason I didn't hire that person was because my ego got in the way, because they were so much more experienced. They were so much more experienced than I was. They had so many more years doing this kind of similar thing to what I was doing. And I was really scared of like, oh God, this person's going to come in. They're going to be better than me. They're going to like jump over me. Right. You know, in the hire. And it wasn't, that was all my stuff. They weren't giving that off in any way, like my stuff. And so I didn't make that hire. And I hired someone else who had more kind of the, like we were talking about, the abilities and the potential. And, you know, she ended up being fantastic and growing in the organization. And, you know, now she runs her own business. Like she's fantastic. But I held myself back. And in startups, especially because I think it's the ego trap is that I have to know everything. I have to get at everything, you know? And so we'll, you know, it's easy to avoid bringing in the expertise around you to support you in being ultimately successful and getting through some of the really hard parts of the early startup time when you're leveling up the organization at every step of the way and the number of headcount goes up and the number amount of revenue you're doing goes up. And, you know, there's all these milestones that you hit where things change. They just do, you know, and you have to be ready for it. And, you know, and you can be willing to learn it and you can have a team who's like going to break their lives in order to learn it, which is essentially what I ended up doing for a lot of that time, you know, or you can also bring in people with the expertise around you who are willing to learn and do things in a more agile way, perhaps, than they've done before. Right. So there has to be a fit there too.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, humility and like being able to have that self-awareness of like, what is my ego? It's okay to have a certain level of ego, right? Like being, having pride in what we do, having pride in our accomplishments. Those are all great things. But just like Popeye, when he overuses one muscle, like it starts to become a detriment and he starts to get lopsided, right? And so when your ego shifts into that unhealthy, like overused area, it starts to be, you know, not serving our needs, you know, in the greater, in the greater spectrum of things. One of my favorite questions I love to ask all my guests is, what is your favorite art? While you think, I ask this because my favorite quote is from a guy named Darren Walker. And he says, without art, there is no empathy. And without empathy, there is no justice.
That's a lovely quote. Interesting. Yeah. I think art definitely, I mean, art is expression. It's, you know, it's someone's humanity, you know, coming out in a particular way or trying to express some collective part of our humanity or the nature that surrounds us as humans, you know, that we're making sense of. And so it's a window into, I think, you know, someone's perspective, you know, that they're seeing the world through. And then that in that experience, we can see ourselves often. And
yes.
So my favorite piece of art is actually downstairs. It's a piece that I was lucky enough to go to Cuba in 2015, right before they actually opened up the, you know, kind of US,
I'm so Cuba. Jealous.
You know, I had a friend, a very close friend who has a family member who lives there. So it was like through kind of the family member that we got to go and have this trip. But anyway, there's this art market in Havana. I think it's called like San Jose Artisans Market, something like that.
Okay.
And there's the piece on my wall downstairs that I found. You go into this space, it's this giant kind of warehouse that like goes on and on and on. And there's just art all over it, like paintings mostly. Whoa. Just like stacked up way high on the, you know, into the kind of up way higher than you can reach. And you can kind of wander around and just see, you know, all this art that comes from the people, you know, there, and mostly local artists. And so you would die. It's amazing.
I can't wait. I'm so looking forward to this now.
And so when I went there, you know, I found this kind of little zone that I loved, and the artist was, it's like Arbielo. I don't speak Spanish very well. It's like Arbielo Rodriguez. And the piece is this, it's this large painting, kind of a desert landscape, but it looks like it's kind of on an angle a little bit, like there's some directionality to it.
Okay.
And then there's all these little figures of people, and they're just a little black kind of splash for the head, a different color for each person's kind of shirt or like dress, and then like little legs, and they're really tiny, and there's all these people kind of spread out moving in the same direction, but are all these different colors. And the piece is called Migration in Spanish. So it's to me, like it's the name kind of gives it a tone, you know, if people are migrating somewhere, they're kind of moving through this desert landscape, they're trying to go where they're trying to go. But I mean, for me, the piece has just taken on so much meaning coming from my Burning Man roots, you know, seeing so many people. And I love the different colors within the piece because it, you know, kind of the landscape of all the different ways people show up and express in a completely blank kind of landscape is really powerful. And then, you know, the piece also for me just has the feeling of, you know, globalism and, you know, some of the injustices that have to go on with that, and, you know, climate change and just the reasons people have to migrate, wars, you know, all these things. And so it's just a multi-layered kind of experience, like, and it just pulls you in, and it gives me this feeling of expansiveness, like these people could be moving towards something better, you know, or they could also be fleeing something horrible, you don't know. But it creates this feeling of empathy for these little figures and imagining oneself, you know, as one in a vast empty desert with all your belongings, you know, trying to get where you need to go, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's got to be my favorite art piece, I think, and it's one that's down in the living room and I just love, you know, staring at.
Oh, that's great. So, mm-hmm. Oh, thank you for sharing that.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sharing that. Victoria, thank you so much for chatting with us, with me, my listeners. Hopefully they are inspired, they learned something, they have a new take on organization culture, and mm-hmm. perhaps sparked something that they can apply back into their venture, profit, not-for-profit, social organization, social group, and what have you. So thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you for doing this and opening up conversations and connecting people, because you are totally a connector. That's very clear.
Thank you so much again, and I can't wait to spend time with you in real life over coffee or cocktails or games
real life.
Thank you for joining us on the PeopleNova podcast. My name is Rachel O'Neill. The team here at PeopleNova Human Capital would love to hear from you. We are always curious to hear from our listeners. So go ahead and send us an email, podcast@peoplenovahc.com, with your workplace questions or suggestions for who you'd like to see on our show. If you send us an audio memo, we may include your question on the show. Lastly, we are here to amplify. Our guests are amazing entrepreneurs, and we want you to forward our newsletter to someone in your network who needs to know the amazing things our guests are doing, so together we can make an impact. Thank you so much. Take care, and we will see you next time.